it's our God.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God?
I am surrounded.
Spirit of
Majesty, to taste and know.
Thank you. your name, Lord Jesus. Praise your name. Glory to your name. Honor to your name. Strength and power and glory to your name. Your name be lifted up. Your name be glorified. We honor you.
Yes,
Lord. We glorify you.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you.
Oh, yes,
Lord. We thank you forever, for eternity, we will be thankful. For eternity, for ages and ages to come, we will ever be thankful for what you have done for us. We thank you. Help us to live these days. Help us to live these short days. Looking for your second coming. Looking for your soon coming. Help us to live these days with one thing, single thing in mind. To see you coming soon.
Even so, Lord, come quickly.
We want to be part of that church that is eagerly waiting for your coming. And may when you come, you find us ready, prepared for your coming. A yep. glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but ready to meet her bridegroom. For her bride has made herself ready for the wedding. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you have done for us in 2020. And we want to thank you for what you are going to do for us in 2021.
Try. Yes, try.
You never change. We know that our future is glorious.
Yes.
We know that our future is bright. Because the path of the righteous shines more and more until it reaches the dawn. Thank you. Thank you that for what is going around us is not happening to us. Thank you that you have set a hedge around us from every side. We are your chosen ones, elected, chosen. And thank you for keeping us alive. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for watching over us. We are alive today to thank you. We don't take that for granted. We are alive today to give you thanks and to witness of your goodness and your mercy and your loving kindness. How good you have been to us and how good you will be to us. We thank you. Thank you for everyone present here, Father. Thank you for bringing them here. Thank you, Father. Thank you for bringing us together as a body of Christ, as a church. We thank you, Father. Keep us strong. Keep us together. Keep us united together. Keep us attached to each other together. To be a lampstand that is shining from this area. To be a lampstand, candlestand, that her light is shining in this area, in Kingman, and even in Kansas. We honor you and we thank you. Give us words today, utterance by the Holy Spirit, inspired words to minister to the hearers. Give us accurate, plain, clear words to speak. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to see your smiley faces. Come in.
Ooh, is the Lord good? I've got a little.
Yeah, it is. Can you bring it closer? A little bit closer.
Oh, can you hear me now? All right.
Yeah.
I've got a, as we were praising the Lord, you know, it come on my heart to pray for some friends of mine. For a deliverance. See, your enemy, this enemy binds us up. He lies to us. He kills, steals, and destroys us. And it's only by the Holy Spirit that these revelations, which is a truth, be known. A revelation is exposed, see, in our own carnal thought, in our own wisdom. The Lord says it's foolishness, our thought process. It's only His wisdom that's wise and merciful and mighty and powerful and true and straight. Ooh, it's good. His wisdom's good. So, but my point, what the Lord put on my heart is I have some friends. They're Chuck and Barbara's friends of ours also. They live here. I have a farm south down by us. And they are going to move back here in about a year. They're going to retire. He's a dentist. It's Ted and Ann Maple. Some of you may know them. I don't know. I've known them for years. They love the Lord. But this enemy has distorted and bound up a lot of our brothers and sisters in Christ. Christ is about freedom. We are free in the presence of the Lord. He paid the price. We have been redeemed. We are free. This enemy, though, will twist our thought and cause this self-righteousness, as we all have. Parts of us is this self-righteousness. We're like, oh, what do we got to do? How do we figure this out? And it's not about us. It's about the Lord has already figured it out. We just get in line with what He's got. We literally just get in line with what the Lord has, because His ways are pure and straight and good and perfect. And He has a plan. Exactly. His ways are not ours. They're high and above, he says us. I want to pray for a deliverance on my brother Ted Maple, and a deliverance on his wife Ann, which is our sister. They're looking for a church. They go to a congregation, and he's a deacon, and they grew up the same church I come to see the Lord in. They preach the death, burial, and resurrection. They have the blood of Christ on them, but they're bound up. They're bound up. They've got a load on them. I want to get it lifted off of their shoulders, out of their mind. And I want a revelation of the Lord to come on them that they can see. So that they can blast off in the kingdom. Break the chains, get the load off, release their feet that they can walk. Lord, I do. I come before you here, Lord. Come, my brothers and sisters here, we all agree, Lord.
Yes.
We pray for a deliverance, Lord.
Yes.
A revelation by your Holy Spirit.
Yes.
On to Ted and Ann Maple, Lord. That their eyes be opened, Lord. That their eyes of their heart open wide.
Yes.
That the blinders and the deceit of the enemy that was on them, Lord, that's on us, each one of us, Lord, that you remove it in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
That the enemy has no place or right to lie and to steal our place with you, Lord.
Yes. Yes.
Has no right, Lord. Yes. We have many brothers and sisters, Lord, your children that are bound up, Lord, that I know, Lord. I ask deliverance on them, Lord, on many of my other brothers and sisters, Lord, that go to congregations that don't go, Lord. I ask for your deliverance. Mm. That your power, Lord, overcomes this darkness, Lord, that's on us as a whole, Lord, that we can walk in your light, that your glory, Lord, shines and is exposed, Lord, by our shortcomings, Lord. The place, Lord, that we can come into your presence.
Yes.
Exposes your greatness, Lord. That you love us, that you never leave us, no matter what, Lord. Yes. That you paid the price. Yes. We belong to you, Lord. I ask in Jesus' name these things, Lord, because you are mighty and powerful. All power is in your hands, Lord. I ask a deliverance on my brother Ted and Ann, Lord. I ask a deliverance, Lord, on our country, on our president, on the people, the Lord, of our country that are running it, Lord.
Yes.
That, Lord, you reveal truth in this whole matter in our country. That you are victorious, Lord, that we see who's in control. Lord, you said, Lord, you put people in power in places. You bring kings up and you take them down, Lord. We stand watching eagerly, Lord, because we know, we know, Lord, that you have all things. And no matter what, Lord, as we sang, we look at your face, Lord, this stuff on this earth disappears, Lord. We stand in your presence. We stand in your victory, the victory you gave to us, Lord, on that cross, that you shed that blood, Lord, that it flows and covers us, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. In fact, everyone stands and comes to my heart right now to pray for relatives or friends that may be in that condition that John explained, or just the enemy blinded their eyes. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, the Bible says, for the gods of this world, this is little g gods, who is Satan, has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to hinder them from seeing the glorious light of the gospel. In a vision one time, Brother Hagin saw the Lord, and the Lord spoke to him about this verse, and he said, no one in his or her right mind will drive on a bridge that is under construction and say, dead end, and they just cross and kill themselves. He said, they have to be drunk. They have to be blinded. And he said, the people around you that you see doing things, crazy stuff, or they are just, they are blinded by the God of this world. And he showed him, he said, you need to take authority over the God, the devil, the enemy who has blinded their minds, hindering them from seeing the light of the gospel. So right now, if you know a friend or a family member or someone that is fall under this category of being blinded, I'm going to lead you in a confession to take authority over the spirit that is hindering and blinding them. And we'll ask the Holy Spirit to open their eyes and give them give them revelation, give them open the eyes of their understanding, according to Ephesians 1:17. Okay, so ready? Satan, we come against you in the name of Jesus, and we're asking, take your hands of their minds. You can mention their names now. You can mention, take your hand of so-and-so minds. I'm resisting you in the name of Jesus. and I'm demanding to leave this person alone. Holy Spirit, open their eyes, open their minds, let them see the truth. Let them see the glorious light of the gospel. In Jesus' name. I believe God wants to hear our prayers related to relatives, friends. He wants us to stand in the gap for these people who don't know how to stand for themselves. Amen. You may be seated. I am thankful and excited for every one of you. I do. Thankful for every one of you, and been praying for every one of you by name. Make me happy to see all your faces. That you are doing well, and you will do well, and you will prosper, and you will succeed. So that make me happy. So I will go start with the admonition the Holy Spirit gave us on the New Year Eve when we had our prayer meeting here. And while I was dismissing the people, these words came out of my spirit. And the more I pondered on them, the Holy Spirit gave me more. So just prepare yourself. You're going to hear that every week. About stay hooked to the local church. Stay hooked. Stay attached to the local church. God has planted you there. Because first of all, there is an enemy that's trying to isolate and take you apart from the body of believers that God placed you there. And once he isolates a sheep out of the flock, the second thing is he begins to devour, steal, and kill. We see that all over. We see Christians on their own. And in their mind, yeah, I can survive me and Jesus. I can survive on my relationship. That is great that you have a personal relationship with Jesus and you can meditate on his word, pray every day. But there is a whole different aspect or view in the word of God when it speaks about believers or the body of believers or a local church. Because the minute you receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, God has planted you in a church. We find that in 1 Corinthians 12:18 says that God has set the members, some of them, no, it didn't say some of them, he said each one of them, that is every single one of you. The minute you receive the Lord Jesus as Lord and Savior, he planted you in a local congregation. He planted you in a local church for a reason. He did not leave you an independent sheep on your own. There is no nothing such thing in New Testament as independent sheep. In fact, it is completely opposite of 1 Corinthians 12. When you read the rest of the chapter and you see that the members are dependent on each other. If one member suffer, all members suffer with him. If one member rejoice, all other members rejoice. He said that there should not be schism or division in the body. So the minute you receive the Lord Jesus, he planted, he grafted you in a local church for a reason. And one of these reasons is to grow up spiritually. And you may think, yes, I can grow up by reading the Word of God, by praying, by watching services, and All of that's great, and you should do that. But this is a personal relation. This is on a personal level. There is a spiritual growth that will come to you only in a church, in a local church where God planted you. I know that sounds a little bit different because we are not accustomed to a church mentality. But if we read Ephesians chapter 4, I'm going to read a few verses. This is not the message, so don't take this out of my time, okay? This is appetizer. Ephesians 4, verse 11. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. Let's stop here. This verse does not speak about a personal life. Not everyone is going to be these five folds on your own. He said he himself gave some, so it's not everyone, this is some. He gave them these gifts. And the following verse tells us why. For the equipping of the saints, that's what we have it here on the our vision, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Till we all come to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to a measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, carried about every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, from whom the whole body joined and knit together. I think this is another term for being hooked, being joined, being knit together, not with yourself, you and yourself, me and I and myself, no. Joined and knit together with other members in the body, by which every joint supplies according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. So much in that verse, but that shows you there is a growth, there is a spiritual growth that will come only when you are attached and knit together with the body. So on one side, on one aspect, there is a personal growth when you feed on the Word, when you pray, when you have your personal relationship with the Lord. That is a personal level. But there is a whole different aspect when you are in the local assembly where God planted you. Because there will be a supply coming from the head of the church to the leaders whom he appointed. God follow a chain of commands. He follow leadership. And we talked about that before, that when Jesus appeared to John to speak to the seven churches in the book of Revelation, he did not bypass the leader or the pastor of these churches and he said, I am going to speak to the congregation. He could. That is Jesus. He didn't. He went through the leader. He went through the, he called him the angel of the assembly, which is the messenger or the pastor of the assembly, to speak a message so he or she, the pastor of that assembly, is speaking to the congregation. Jesus did not bypass the leadership of that congregation to speak to them. Even he could. Yet he chose to deliver the messages, especially in the end of times. The book of Revelation speaks about end of times. He chose to speak to the leader, to the one who was over the church, so that one or that one can deliver the message to the church. That's what we're talking about when you are in a church that is hearing from God, not any kind of church. I have been in churches that, and not start speaking negative about them, but really nothing going on. But when you are in a church that is hearing from God, receiving supply, hearing from the head of the church, you will receive a supply And I boldly can say, you cannot get it on your own. You will get a supply from the head of church. You cannot get it on your own. That's why it is important to be in the right church. Years ago, I was going from one congregation to another, one church to another, and I was seeking the Lord. My heart was right. I said, where am I supposed to belong? Which church? And a mentor of mine at that time, he gave me a key that I never forgot. He said, which church the Lord speak to you when you get there? And when he said that, it was like a light bulb. I knew exactly which one. Which one the Lord speaks to you and deal with you. That is a good indicator that this is the right place where you belong. Because when you get in the right place, you begin to hear from the head of the church through the leadership of that church. And when he said that, immediately I know that is where I belong. And I knew it, but I wasn't able to like pinpoint where it is. And during the years, that principle helped me to find out where I should belong in a local church. Where is the church that God speaks to you? Where is the church that you hear from God? So keep that in mind, because the days that are coming on us are difficult, hard times that we need to pay attention. We've been on some weeks now on the series about the signs of the end of times, a subject that I never taught before, never thought I will, but I had impressed on my heart the Lord showed me that this is the time. We need to get into that. So turn with me to Romans chapter 13 and verse 11. And this is our founding scripture for this series. Let's say it together. Let me know when you're ready. And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. Let's do it one more time. And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. One more time. And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. And we've been saying, we've been asking, what time the Holy Spirit wants us to know? January 24th, 11 o'clock a.m. No, this is not the time he asked us to know. The word here, the Greek word, is not for natural words, natural time, but for seasons or events. The NLT translation says, understanding the present time. So the thing that the Holy Spirit wants us to know is to understand the present time, the season we are in. And when you understand the present time, you begin to respond to the events that is happening in a right and correct way. The opposite will be true. When you don't understand the times, you will not be able to respond correctly. I'll give you an example in the natural. I know you're going to laugh, but it is a true example. Years ago, when I was in Bible school in Tulsa, Oklahoma is known for its tornadoes. In fact, in 2013, a tornado hit. It was the worst in the history of the state. Wiped away, half of Oklahoma City. We went there and helped with the help team. So I think it was two or three tornadoes I witnessed when the 4 years I lived in Tulsa. One day, There came a tornado alerts on the phone, but because I did not have internet on my phone, on purpose, I did not have internet in the house I was living in, no TV, and I didn't know about the alerts, what was happening, and came at midnight. Well, most of the students, the school sent warning and asked them to run to the school for shelter, and I didn't know about that either. And they were looking for me, and they trying to call me, and I put my phone silent all night. So there was no way for me to know what was happening. I was unaware. Anyway, ended up that I slept in the tornado. It wasn't a pleasant experience, but I did. And the next day, I found out what's happening, and the students were asking, where you were? Where you been? We were here until 2 o'clock in the morning, until the tornado passed. I said, well, I was sleeping. This is where I was. So when I wasn't aware of the timing of what was happening, the events that's happening around me, I slipped in. And that's why this verse speaks about when you understand the time, it is a time to awake out of sleep. Is he talking about you getting up from everyday sleep? No, this is not about natural sleep. But when you understand what is happening around you, you will get out of a spiritual sleep or spiritual slumber. That's what this mean is. So that's why we need to understand the timing we are living in. So I'm asking you, after 3 Sundays teaching about that, what time are we living in today? Good students, we are in the last days, according to Acts 2:17, and it shall come to pass, this is Peter on the day of Pentecost, it says, it shall come to pass in the last days that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, young men shall see vision, old men shall see dreams. Since the day of Pentecost, a time period called last of days started. And since that time, the church is still in that time period called last of days and will stay until the coming of the Lord when he come to take the church away, catching away of the church. This area is called the last days. And if we have the calendar or the diagram we have, that if the church for 2,000 years have been living in the last days, then today we are living in the last of the last days. Day 5 and day 6 represent the church, the time of the church. Day 5 started on on the day of Pentecost with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and we are living at the very end of day 6, which is the 6,000 years. This is where we are living. We are living at the very end of the last days. Thank you. We can take it down. We will be back to that slide again. But the Bible says that at the very end or the very last of the last days, there will be events coming that really will be unprecedented. In fact, he said, perilous times shall come at the last days. And these times will be difficult, will be hard to bear. And I believe this is what the Holy Spirit wants us to understand, what is happening around us. We are living at the very end, at the very end of these last days. And could be very possible that this generation will be the generation that will see the coming of the Lord. As exciting as it is, there will be events that is happening that never happened before. Not in a good way. It will be hard. It will be difficult. Because Satan is working hard how to destroy the local church before the coming of Jesus. Because Jesus is coming for his brides, and Satan is working hard how to mess up with this bride before Jesus coming. Because Jesus is coming for a glorious church, not a weak church, not a compromising church. He is coming for a glorious church. So Satan is working hard to mess up with this local church. And we saw that in 2020. We saw things we never saw happening in the local church. That's why the Holy Spirit is advising, admonishing us, stay connected, stay hooked to the local church. So back to that, that at the end of time, there will be events happening that is difficult to bear, difficult to sustain, hard. And during these events, we need to learn how to respond to these events from a biblical standpoint. So today will be how to respond from a biblical standpoint to the events that's happening to you and happening to us. I'm going to give some examples. Last year, we encountered something that our generation never experienced before. If we ask how many of you lived a global pandemic, none of us. The last one was 1930 or 1920. We really experienced something we never experienced before. What was the response of the church to that event? Knowing that Jesus prophesied that toward the end of the times there will be pandemics, there will be pestilence. The Greek word is will be pandemics, will be viruses. One of the things that Jesus spoke about the end of times will be global wide or will be worldwide. So Jesus already talked about that, Matthew 24, Luke 21, about pestilence coming, wars coming. How did the church respond to that? Unfortunately, it wasn't a biblical response. And I'm not getting into details, we did not have a biblical response. We didn't have a background how to respond to a pandemic. We didn't. It took us by surprise. And the things that got our attention was Satan succeeded to bring division out of that into the local church. And that was exactly what he wanted to do. Exactly what he wanted to do is to bring to divide the local church. So, an example here in our congregation, I'm not saying that in a bad way, we were divided into between mask or non-mask, open or close. And really, each side has their own views and have their own right. I mean, rational things. Should we stay open or close for safety? Should we wear mask or not wear mask? Pastor Yancy, when he came here in August, I asked him to speak about marriage. That was a series that we were teaching about that time. A week before, he said, I'm not feeling teaching about that. I'm teaching something different. And he came here and taught us about that. The church that he's seeing about that, he said, churches are divided. He said, I saw churches split over a mask. And that is exactly what Satan wanted. Bring division to the local church. Fast forward to 2021. We're starting with a political upheaval. Another card Satan is playing. And can you see what is happening in the church with that political upheaval? Another division. Because everyone has his or her own point of view of what should happen in the country, how the people should run the country. I'm speaking right, or? Every single one of us has his or her own views of what should happen in the White House or what happened in Washington, D.C. And do you know what is the outcome of that? Division. And that's exactly what he's trying to do, to bring division to the local church. I have several examples. I will just pick one. Back home, 10 years ago, when we had this political upheaval and people were coming against the government, corrupt government. Things very much similar to what's happening here. And my family, extended family, uncles, where they were getting together, and one night they had a discussion about each one has his own view of what should happen and what the president should do and what should not do. And it was intense arguments. Do you know what the impact of that arguments that knight had on the nation the next day? Nothing. The following month? Nothing. But do you know what impact it has on our family? Both my uncles didn't talk to each other for several months. That was the impact they had after this discussion. So, interesting. Just a few days ago, the dean at Rhema sent us a group text for the students about things about related to what is happening. And one student just rattling him with things I was shocked to read in the message. I had to delete the whole application. It was WhatsApp. I deleted the whole application. I couldn't even sustain the word that was this girl was talking to the dean of the school. Going to the social media, going to Facebook, seeing many of my friends, spirit-filled, tongue talker, divided over what should happen and what should not happen in the country. And I'm seeing that and saying, the same card is being played again and is succeeding. Satan is succeeding to divide the church, to divide the local body against each other. Because everyone has his own or her point of view of what should happen and what should not happen. And guess what? Whatever you think it should happen and should not happen, it's never going to happen in the White House. This is not the way we're going to change the nation. This is not the way we are going to change the United States. It's not by arguments, it's not by sharing what I think. Oh, Pastor, I need to vent. I need to vent on social media. After you venting, what that changed in the White House or Washington, D.C.? Nothing. Zero. Do you know what changed it? What changed it is you got in one group and other friends you have on that social media got in another group and you got fight and you got an argument about what my point of view and what your point of view. And you fall right in the trap of the enemy. That's the exact trap he wants to drag you in, is to get into a division. That's why we got to wake up. Say the wake up. Wake up. Wake up. So today I'm going to talk about politics. Yeah. What is the definition of politics? Can you define politics? You all talk about politics and you don't know how to define it? Really? What is the definition of the word politics? Okay. It's the art of governing. The art of this is a simple definition, the art of governing. How to govern. How to govern your own family, how you govern a whole nation. So political politics in a nationwide, it will be how to govern a nation. And in the United States, we have two major ways of governing, two mindsets or two systems of governing. One of them is conservative way of government, and the other is liberal way of government. We agree on that? These are the two major ways of governing the nation. Now the question is, which political party God belongs to? We know for sure he doesn't belong to the Democratic. We know that. Is he conservative? Some of you may think that he is conservative. He joined the Republican Party. No, he doesn't, and he will not. I shared with you the message I heard from the church, my church back in Branson that I watch every week, about Brother Keith talking to the Lord about what's happening here, and he said, I heard three phrases that I never expect to hear from the Lord. The Lord spoke to him and said, I am not Republican, and I am not Democratic, and I am not American. He's not Republican. He will never be. Then what political party or what government God belongs to? God has a system of governing that's completely different than the system of this world. And his governing is called kingdom. The Western nation don't know a lot about kingdoms. Our nation was a kingdom before it turned to be a republican. Not republican, republic. It was a kingdom. And in a kingdom, there is only one voice matter. That is the king. In a republic, the people, we the people, are the voice, right? Take that 180 degree opposites, and that will be the kingdom. In a kingdom, people's voices do not matter. Not irrespectively, but that is the case. There is only one voice. There is only one person in the thing, is the king. And God is not a republic. He doesn't have a republican system. He's a king and he has a kingdom. Isaiah, if we can put Isaiah 9, 6 on the screen. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. And this is the only place in all Old Testament the word government is mentioned. Here we are seeing politics here, biblical politics. And the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government, the peace there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward and forever. Don't expect justice everywhere except in the kingdom of God. He is the just judge and he is the just God. And he has a kingdom. And he said, the kingdom shall be on his shoulders. Why he said on his shoulders? There are different interpretations. I like to go to the one that is more the Bible interpret, the way the Bible interpret itself. Jesus is a symbol of the high priest in the Old Testament. And Aaron, who was the high priest, his garments on his shoulder, there will be two stones. In Exodus, if we can put Exodus 28, 12, this is part of the garment of the high priest. And remember, Jesus is a type of a high priest. So in Exodus 28, verse 12, talking here about Aaron, he said, take Aaron, your brother, and his sons. And he said, you shall put the two stones on the shoulders of the ephod as a memorial stones for the sons of Israel. And Aaron shall bear their names before the Lord on his two shoulders as a memorial. So you can see that the two stones on the shoulder are representation of the people, the children of Israel. Why two stones? Without getting into a lot of details, one stone represents the nation of Israel, the other stone represents the Gentiles. And that shows you that at the end, both the Jews and the Gentiles, that is us, we are going to reign with him. Because he said the government shall be on his shoulders. And he said, you shall put bear their names before the Lord on his shoulders. Your name is on the shoulder of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because you are going to reign with him. That's what Romans 5:17, that we shall reign with him. That is the type of the government that God has. He's a king, and he has a kingdom. And I'm going to read to you an article, short article about the church by Rick Renner, who is a Greek scholar. And I'm going through it quickly. He said, I want to share with you the meaning of the word church as it is understood in the first century. He said, the term the Holy Spirit chose to describe the newly emerging Christian community was the Greek word ekklesia. Ekklesia, the Greek word for the church. And he said, this word is composed of ek and kelio, two words, means the idea of separation and the idea of call. So when you put these words together, the ekklesia will describe those who are called and separated as an assembly. He said, the earliest example of the ekklesia is found in the writings about Athens, when it was used to denote a prestigious assembly of Athenian citizens who regularly met to discuss civil matters. At these meetings, the distinguished citizens determined the laws, debated public policy, formulated new policies, argued and ruled in judicial matters, and so forth. They were called out of the society and invited to be a member of this assembly, which is called ekklesia. The reason the Holy Spirit chose the word ekklesia to describe God's people becomes more and more evident as one studies this subject. The New Testament meaning for ekklesia is clear. The local church is a body of individuals who have been called out, called forth, and separated for the purposes of God. The church is God's assembly in every town and city, composed of people who have been saved and called out to make eternal decisions that will affect the atmosphere of the local region. God never intended for the local church to be simply a quiet, hidden body of believers. Rather, he intended for the church to be his voice and ruling power in each community, a special assembly comprised of people who have been called out to make decisions that will impact the atmosphere of the local environment for God. Therefore, when the New Testament used the word ekklesia to depict the local church, it is conveying an incredibly important message right from the start. God's plan for each congregation was not that they hide and cower in fear, but rather that they rise to a position of power, influence in the place where God has called them to fulfill their specific assignment for their region. The church was intended to be a brilliant beacon of light in the midst of a dark and troubled towns, cities, and regions. The believers in the early New Testament were suffering terribly at the direct consequences of persecution. Church meetings had to be conducted in secret because swift retribution would be brought upon them if their actions were ever made known. Yet despite the fact that these believers were suffering immensely and forced to meet in secret, Christ still acknowledged them for who they are, his ekklesia, called out from the world and separated to exercise spiritual power, pay attention, separated to exercise a spiritual power over the bleak and seemingly hopeless atmosphere that surrounded them. That was the purpose of the church. Regardless of how dark and oppressive the situation seemed to be, or how much these believers struggled, it did not change Jesus' view of them. They were his precious appointed ekklesia, his governing body in their respective towns, cities, and regions. That is still how Jesus views the local church. And pay attention, each body of believers has its own specific assignments. We have our assignment here. Each believer is assigned to a specific ekklesia. I didn't write that, but when I saw it this morning, I said, well, that is exactly what the Holy Spirit is talking to us. He said, every believer is assigned to a specific local assembly. All local bodies fit within a larger common purpose to further the kingdom of God on the earth by equipping the saints. So I encourage you to ask yourself today, do I know in my heart that I am planted firmly in my God-ordained company of believers? Am I positioned in the ecclesia that holds his assignment for the season of my life? So, since you and I became the part of the ecclesia, or separated, or called out for God's kingdom, what will be the atmosphere of our influence in our governments, natural governments? When someone accepts Jesus as Lord, he became part of the kingdom of God. And since Jesus is a king and he has a kingdom, then believers should go and take over the government. Right? Because he's a king. What is the sphere of the influence of our ruling and governing with him? What is the sphere of our dominion? How much can we make changes in the political arena of our where we live? First of all, we have to identify that Jesus' kingdom is not of this world. Otherwise, when someone gets saved, we send them right to Washington, D.C. We bid them farewell. Probably we're not going to see them again. In John 18, 36, when Jesus was standing before Pilate and he asked him, "Who you are?" He said, "My kingdom is not of this world." Jesus is a king and he has a kingdom, but he said, "My kingdom is not of this world." He said, "If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here." Pilate therefore said to him, "Are you a king then?" Jesus said, "You say right, I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the earth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." So Jesus here acknowledged that he is a king and he has a kingdom. Well, if Jesus is a king and he has a kingdom, why they crucified him? Why they persecuted the early Christian church and they did horrible things to them? If we are kings and priests, as the Bible say, why we just don't take over our governments? Because we are members of a kingdom that is not of this world. But we don't separate that in our minds as Christians. And that is the main reason that I shared about last week, why Christians get so involved in politics. Because they cannot separate between who they are and what is happening around them. Yes, you are a citizen of this nation, but you are a believer. You are a citizen of another nation. You are a part of another kingdom that is not of this world. And if your master, who is a king and he has a kingdom, was spit on and crucified in this world, so don't expect to take over the government. Jesus didn't come to overthrow the Roman government. He didn't come to establish a political party. That was not the reason he came for. He didn't come to have a political party and political views of how the Roman government. How many times Jesus talked about the Roman government, how should they run the country? None, zero. Because he has another kingdom. He is a king and he is has another kingdom. And he talked a lot about the kingdom, his kingdom. He did not talk about the Romans' kingdom, or the Romans' empire. He talked about his kingdom. In fact, after he rose from the dead, 40 days he appeared to the disciples. Do you know the only thing he taught them during that time? He taught them the things related to the kingdom. The thing that was running in Jesus' mind was not the Roman Empire and what is happening in the Roman Empire back then. The thing that was running for in his mind was his kingdom and how you and I, as a citizens of this kingdom, how should we behave? So don't forget who you are. I know you are an American citizen, but you have another citizenship. The Jewish missed it because they were looking for an earthly kingdom. They were looking for a king who actually will establish an earthly kingdom and deliver them from the Roman Empire. And when Jesus didn't do that, he didn't came in that form as an earthly king, they rejected him. Do you know, many Christians don't see it this way. They're still looking to an earthly kingdom, an earthly ruling of Jesus over nations, which will never happen nowadays. It's not going to happen. They're falling in the same mistake the Jewish nation fell, because they were looking for an earthly establishment of peace and God is ruling over. It's not going to happen, not according to the scripture. So, need to get to the point, why Jesus is not ruling on the earth today? Why? Because there is a time for his ruling when he come to establish a literally earthly kingdom. And this time is not now. It's not going to happen now. There is a time when he will actually come to establish an earthly kingdom out of Jerusalem. And we are going to reign with him, but this time is not now. So don't engage in so much politics. It's not your business. It's not your business now. One day we are going to rule with him, then what we say is going to happen as the kings and priests, but not now. Can we put the diagram once again that we talked about, which is called Adam's six-day worksheet? What's Adam's six-day worksheet? The Jewish people, they said that according to the Jewish tradition, Moses received not only the Ten Commandments on the mountain, but he received the oral teaching that passed from one generation to another. They teach that Moses was told by God that Adam has been given a six-day worksheet. God worked in 6 days, and Adam has been given dominion over the earth for 6 days. We have Psalm 90, verse 4, and 2 Peter 3, 8. It says that one day with the Lord as a 1,000 days. So 6 days work started from day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six. Each one is 1,000 years. Bring us to the day that we are living in. We are living in almost 6,000 years. And he said, Adam was given dominion over the earth for 6 days because God worked in 6 days and he gave Adam dominion over 6 days. So for 6 days or 6,000 years, this time is called Adam's lease, where Adam is ruling over the earth. That is not time for God to rule over the earth. The seventh day, which is the millennium day reign, that is when God himself will rule over the earth in the seventh day. But for 6 days, this period of time is Adam's dominion over the earth. God cannot rule over the earth during this period of time. How many of you lived in rented homes that was leased, rented homes? I lived in a rented home in Tulsa, and every year my lease were renewed. I did not own the house, but there was an owner. She was a Christian. And the owner, after she leased the house to me, she did not have a right to enter the house after she gave me the key and signed the contract. She would not have a right to enter the house as long as I have a contract with her. But when I terminated the contract, it is her house. She can get in at any time. In Genesis 1, God leased the earth to mankind for 6,000 years. We're going to look into that. When he said, let us create man on our image and our likeness and let them have dominion over the earth. From that day forward, God leased or gave the control or the dominion over the earth to Adam. And he said, you have been given that dominion for 6 days or 6,000 years. During that time, God is the owner of everything, the creator of everything. He cannot legally enter the earth without permission from Adam or mankind. That's why prayer is important, because we allow God to interfere in our earth. We give him permission to get to our earth, because we've been given that dominion since Genesis 1. But what happened in Genesis 3? It was sold out. Adam made a mistake. He sold out, and he sold his dominion over the earth to Satan. And from that day forward, Adam became a slave to Satan, and Satan became the ruler and the master of this earth. 4 different scriptures in the New Testament. I have to go through them real quick. Speak about Satan, the ruler of the earth. The first one will be John 14:30. I no longer talk with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he has nothing in me. Second Corinthians 4:4, if we can put the scriptures. Whose mind the god of this world, this age. This is the second scripture speak about Satan. He is the god, little g, god of this age. Ephesians 2:2, in which once you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. 1 John 5:19, we know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. The Amplified says, under the power of the evil one. Good word news says, under the control of the evil one. As much as these scriptures, many Christians, they don't believe that way. And you hear it. Oh, God is in control. But God is in control. Control of what? Control of the earth? Not long ago, I have that discussion in the office with some people. They wanted to argue. God is in control, and nothing happened without his permission. So you're telling me that God is in control over the earth, and he allowed that virus to happen because he is in control. Control of what? Control of what's happening in the earth, then he has things in a mess. If he's the one controlling, then things are out of his control. The truth is, the Bible says that the whole world is under the control and the power of the wicked one. And that's going to stay until Adam's lease is over. After Adam's lease is over, God is going to be in control. And I'm going to show you exactly what will happen when God will be in control. The first thing is, the curse will be taken out of the world for 1,000 years. Satan will be bound for 1,000 years. There will be no death. People will live, longevity will be restored. People will live for 300-400 years. A child will be 100 years old. That is when God is in control. But don't tell me that God is in control now. He ain't. He is not in control. When I lived in Oklahoma.
I like it,
In Matthew 8, verse 29, these are the two demons-possessed men. Jesus came to, when he encountered them, they said something that is true. We think that Satan can lie. He is a liar, but sometimes he says things that's true. He said, they cried out saying, what have we to do with you, Jesus, the Son of God? Have you come here to torment us? Before the time. Satan knew that he has a time here on the earth where he is a ruler. And when they saw Jesus and recognized him as the Son of God, they challenged him. They said, are you coming before the time to torment us? It will be like you signed a contract to lease a house, and after six, like for example, for a year, after 6 months, the owner come or the landlord come and say, hey, get out of here. Say, no, I have a lease with you for a year. You can't get me out of here, right? This is exactly what they were telling him. You can't get us out of this earth before the time. And Jesus didn't. He didn't. He did not send them to hell or Hades. In a vision in that book, Brother Hagin has a vision, and Jesus told him, he said, he was explaining that very scripture. He said, if I could, when I was on the earth, to send demons to hell, I would have sent all of them and left nothing for you to deal with. If I could send, but he said, that was not their time yet. They still have a legal, do you see, legal right to stay on the earth until Adam's lease is over. I cannot kick them out of the earth before their time. That will be illegal from God's standpoint. That's why Jesus had to send them to the swine and they killed the swine. He did not send them to hell to be tormented. That's why he said, did you come here before time to torment us? Satan knew his time, that his time is not over yet. Then, when that time is going to happen? Are you excited for that? When that's going to happen? 1 Corinthians 15 speak about the time when God is going to put an end to every rule, authority, and power, and dominion. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 23, but to each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward those who are Christ are at his coming. Then comes the end. What ends speaking about here? Well, you have to interpret it according to the context. The end is speaking about here is the end of Adam's lease. The end of the ruling or dominion of Adam over the earth, the mankind over the earth. He said, then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, to deliver the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and authority and power. The end will come at the end of the 6,000 years when Jesus will put an end to every human government, to every human rule and every authority and every government. Then comes, another translation says, he will destroy all rule and all authority and every power. And that was going to happen at the end of the 7 years tribulation. We've been talking about that in details in the Wednesday's night, about when Jesus will come back at the end of the 7 years and everyone, every tribe will see him. They will see him with their eyes. And they will recognize him. The Bible says he will put his feet on the mountain of Olives and the mountain will be split into two pieces. And that is when he will establish an earthly kingdom out of Jerusalem. And the Bible says he will judge the nation. The whole nations will come to him to judge. I really don't have time to go through that, but we talked in details about this. He will bind Satan for 1,000 years. Revelation 20, verse 1. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hands. And he laid hold of that dragon. I'm just looking for that moment when I see it. That serpent of old, who is the devil, the Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should not deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years were finished. But all these things must he be released for a little while. This will be the end of Satan's rule over the earth. During 1,000 years, millennium, Satan will not be ruling over the earth. Adam will not be ruling over the earth. It's over. That will be the time when Jesus will be a king, literal king over the earth. And the Bible says that we will rule with him. Psalm 47, whenever you read this psalm is a millennial psalm. It is not psalm that you can use at any time. It is a, and we're going to see why. Psalm 47, whenever I wrote that in every Bible I use, it is for the millennium. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout to the Lord with a voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is an awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. You cannot take that and interpret it about today that he is a great king over the earth. He is not. Not now, not yet. One day he is coming, but not yet. Verse 3, he will subdue the peoples under us, nations under our feet. If that's happening now, if that is happening now, he is subduing nations under our feet. No, that's going to happen when we rule with him over nations. In one of you remember the parable that Jesus gave about the 5 minas and 5 talents, 2 talents, 1 talent, when he said, good and faithful servant, you were faithful in the little, I will set you over 10 cities, I will set you over 5 cities. Remember that? That was what's going to happen in the millennium, where what we will be doing as a Christians here on our own. Depending on what we will doing with our assignments, we will be assigned to cities and nations in the millennium. He said, I'm going to set you over 10 cities. I'm going to set you over 5 cities. That's going to happen in the millennium. So here in verse 3, he will subdue the people under us, nations under our feet. Verse 7, for God is the king of all the earth. Sing praises and with understanding. Is God the king over the earth today? Not yet. Verse 8, God reigns over the nations. God reigns over the nation. That didn't happen yet. That's why when you read the Bible, you have to understand dispensations. What's mean dispensations? What this verse, when this verse is going to apply? Is on the past or the present tense or future tense. This whole psalm is a millennial psalm. It's going to happen in the future. That's when he says God is going to reign over the nations. He is going to be the king over all the earth. And this, when that happens, we can talk politics then. But until then, how can we change our nation? I'm finishing. From now to there, how we can change our nation? Is it a call to be a passive believer and just have nothing to do? And that's, well, there are two sides of the thing. You have the one ditch, which believers say we have nothing to do with here with our government, or let them do whatever, and we just have our own. One time I was like that in the denomination I grew up. We have nothing to do with the government. We just like people that's waiting for the second coming. And you can take that to the extreme other end where people get so, believers get so involved in politics that they forget who they are. But there is a middle of the roads. How can we change our nations? Because our nation is in a mess. How can we do that? Through the biblical way. There is a biblical way. How can we pray for our nations? I'm going to read from that book a paragraph, short paragraph, about how to change your nation biblically. We are going to look at two men in the Old Testament who changed their nation through prayer. If you want to see how people of the Bible changed nations, study their prayer lives and see how they prayed, and you will find they prayed in line with the words. Abraham's intercession for Sodom and Gomorrah is an example of how God's covenant people can intercede and affect the course of events in this world, so God's purposes can be fulfilled regardless of Satan's plans. How did Abraham affect change in his nation? Abraham's intercession teach us that it does not take a great number of believers to effect a change on this earth through prayer. Because the Bible says, if two of you agree on the earth touching anything, it shall be given to them. Ezekiel 22:30 says, I sought for a man among them that he should stand in the breach and repair the breach so I will not destroy. It takes one person to make the difference. Then in a 1979 vision, Brother Hagin saw three frogs coming out of the Atlantic Ocean that's attacking the United States. And this is what the Lord spoke to him. He said, if the Christians of this nation had done what I told them to do in my words and had prayed for the leaders of their country, they could have kept those evil spirits that you saw in that vision from operating in this nation. None of those upheavals would have occurred in your nation. You would not have had the political, social, and economical disturbances in this nation. And the presidents never would have made the mistakes he made. Let's speak about the Watergate scandal. In fact, I'm holding the church responsibility for the president's mistakes. When I heard Jesus say that, I cried. I said, oh my God. And I began to weep. Jesus continued, he said, yes, the church is responsible before God Almighty. I know when you tell that to some Christian, they will laugh. But you wait until they stand before my judgment seat and see if they will laugh when they are the ones who will be receiving the judgment. He said, Jesus was saying that Christians could have stopped those evil strategies of the devil by taking their place on social media. No, in prayer, based on the word of God. Christians have authority on the earth in the name of Jesus. And if Christians have prayed for those in authority, America would not have had the riots or the political and economical upheavals you experienced in your nation in the 1970s. There is so much here, I have to stop here. But the point is, how can we bring change to our nation through the biblical way? And the biblical way is praying for our leaders and praying for our nations. Let's stand on our feet and we pray for them. Yes, come in. Okay, come in.
About a year ago, the Lord gave me a dream. I think I've shared this dream with you before, but this week I've got some revelation, new revelation of this dream. And when I seen it, it was like, oh my goodness, why didn't I see this before? But I couldn't have because we weren't here yet. The dream that the Lord gave me was that I was in a car. I was driving a limousine. There was a woman with me. The back seat was the President of the United States, President Trump. And we were headed down a road, but I knew I needed to get turned around to get back to the White House. Hmm. And when I was going down this road, I jumped this ravine. That ravine is right here, right now. But we need to be praying for him. There was bullets, there was grenades, there was every type of thing you could possibly think of hitting this car. The church, the bride, the woman was in the car with me was the bride, which is the church. We need to get him back in the White House. We need to be praying, as the pastor just said, we need to be praying for our leaders. He's still our leader in God's eyes.
Yes. Amen. Father, we praying according to your words to pray first of all for our kings and leaders and everyone who is in a position of authority, that we may live a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness, for this is acceptable and well-pleasing to you. Father, we praying, Father, for the people in the White House and the people in the Congress, the Senate, both chambers, the senators and the Congress, the House of Representatives. Father, we praying for the lights to shine. Father, we asking that they will see the lights. Father, we're asking that the God of this world, that we take authority over this demonic activities happening over there, Father. We bind them in the name of Jesus. And Father, we're praying that the light and the truth will prevail. We're praying that the leaders will see the light, will see the glorious light of the gospel. And Father, we're asking to intervene in behalf of our nation. We're asking for your will, that your will and your purposes for this great nation to come to pass. We're asking, Father, that the role and the place that this nation has to fulfill, that she will be able to fulfill her purpose and her place as you planned and you designed for her. Help us, Father, and keep us from getting in divisions. Keep us united. We're asking in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let me warn you one more time. Stay away from political arguments. It's not going to do anything except more divisions. Stay away from political arguments. It's not going to make any change. In fact, it will have a negative impact on you and your spiritual life. Amen. I have a few announcements. You should have got your year of giving reports, and we have another report for the what the Lord has done here in the church. If there is any thing that's need correction in your giving reports, you can reach to our bookkeepers if there is anything. If there is any corrections in the other report about the church, grammatical report, don't talk to me, okay? The second announcement will be this Wednesday. We will have Jan Jones will be speaking on Wednesday. She has a message. She has something on her heart to share on Wednesday. So come expecting. Then comes Friday. Friday, we have our sister Peggy that she is moving her daughter, and it is a situation that happened urgent. And she asking for help. She needs people to unload with her. She will be driving a 26-foot, the biggest truck. And she needs people to help. So that will be on Friday afternoon. I will be there. But we need at least 2-3 people to help with unload. Depending on your physical, we will not put anything heavy on you, but we just need help to in that situation. And she's asking for our help. So contact me so we know how many is coming. And also, we're going to have dinner that day for you, so don't worry about that. And there are two other things happening on Friday. Do you like to talk about that?
Yes.
And you?
So the youth is going to help as well with the unloading Peggy's daughter.
You don't have a choice for that.
Yeah. It's our fun Friday night. We're going to do some service to start with, and then we'll have, of course, feed whoever is helping. And then we're going to watch Noah from the Sight and Sound Theater here on our big screens and sound system here at the church. So we'll have our fun night. And so everyone is invited to stay after we help unload and eat, whatever order that's in, whatever time that gets started. You're invited to come in here and watch Noah with us after that.
And
this Friday at 6:30 is the men's Bible study here at the church.
So this is what we need. If you are coming either for men's group or for helping or for the, just for the movie, we need your name so we can get a head count and prepare dinner for that. So we're going to have fellowship. So whatever the cause, the reason you're coming, either for men's group or for the movie, and the men's, you can bring your wives if you like. They can watch the movie during that time. Noah, it's a great movie, great production by Sight and Sounds. So it can be a whole thing, a fellowship for the whole family. So bring your family if you like. And if you can help with Peggy, that will be great. But again, we need names, we need numbers, so we can prepare for the meals. We got that?
What time do you have for the help, Peggy?
Well, she will give me a call when she leaves Oklahoma. She will be driving in Oklahoma. She said afternoon, Friday afternoon. She does know exactly her arrival time. So if you are planning to help, let me know so I can be in touch with you when I hear from her about her arrival time. Okay? Right.
And today we have a meal following here. We have literally a ton of
yes.
soup, probably 2,000 pounds of soup for real. And it's for everyone. We have lots of food. So please
Amen.
Stay, even if you weren't aware of it and or you didn't bring anything or whatever. We have a lot of soup and a good variety and some desserts. And then following is our annual business meeting, which everyone is invited to stay and to listen to the blessings that God has given us in this last year and the report of that. After that, we're begging for some help to take down our Christmas trees. So if you want to stay and get out of the Christmas spirit, not really, but to help put some things away, that would be wonderful. And just a thought, I don't know, I haven't talked to a pastor about this, but if there's a lot of soup left over, we could leave it here, freeze it, and add that Friday night. So if you're willing to donate that, it might help lessen the load on preparing food for Friday night. Okay? And let's do our, take our offering, if the ushers would come forward.
Water bottle, and so you can see.
set it there or any other things that you need.
All right.
That's a gift from him.
Works for me. Or I can not drop it.
Ooh.
There you go.
Can y'all hear me for just a minute? I have something I forgot to share with you guys. It's really important. Listen up.